All right, so now we're ready to dive in and actually work out some math that turned out not to be so bad, but it ends up being okay specifically because we were very careful about setting up all the definitions to lead us to this moment in time. It is our destiny, Charles.
Oh, good. I love destiny. Is this Destiny's Theorem?
No, actually, it turns out it's Haussler's Theorem.
Yeah, is Haussler like German for destiny?
It might be, but I don't think it is. So Haussler is the name of a person in this particular case. And what he worked out is a way of bounding the true error as a function of the number of training examples that are drawn.
Oh, nice.
So let's consider, from the hypothesis set that we have, all the hypotheses can be categorized as to whether or not they have high true error or low true error.
Sure.
All right. So let's let each one through HK be the ones that have, a priori, they have high true error. What we'd like to do is make sure that as we're drawing data sets, that we have knocked all these guys out. We've gotten enough examples that actually allow us to verify that they have high error. So they have high error on the training set. So they have high training error. Right. So how much data do we need to establish that these guys are actually bad? All right. So let's take a look at the probability that if we draw an input from this distribution D, that for any of these hypotheses, HI and this set of bad hypotheses, that it will match the true concept, right? So that H sub I of X is equal to C of X. And we know that that's less than or equal to 1 minus epsilon. It's unlikely that they match because it's likely, relatively likely, that they mismatch, right? That's what this exactly means, this error being greater than epsilon.
Oh, I see. So if I have an error of greater than epsilon, that means that the probability that I'm wrong is greater than epsilon, which means the probability that I'm right is 1 minus epsilon, less than 1 minus epsilon. Okay, that makes
That's
sense.
Right. Yeah. So it's sort of a relatively low probability of match.
Well, if epsilon is high.
Low relative to 1 minus epsilon.
Right. Okay.
So this is a fact about the hypothesis in the abstract. For any given sample set, we've got a set of m examples. And what we'd like to know is, since we're trying to knock it out, what's the probability that even after we've drawn m examples, that this hypothesis, H sub I, it remains consistent with C, right? Even though it doesn't really match all that well, we've drawn m examples, and it still looks like it matches. It's still in the version space. So the probability that that happens, if it were the case that everything was independent, is going to be 1 minus epsilon raised to the m power. Right, because it's less than 1 minus epsilon to be wrong once, well, which is to say that you're consistent once. To continue to be consistent, we keep having to have this probability come true. So it's going to be, we're going to just keep multiplying it in again and again and again. So 1 minus epsilon raised to the m power.
Right, so that makes sense because you're basically saying it's consistent with the first example and the second example and the third example and dot, 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 the mth example. So, with independent variables, is just multiplication. So, it's 1 minus epsilon times 1 minus epsilon times 1 minus epsilon m times, which is just 1 minus epsilon to the m. Okay, I see that.
Great. All right, so can we use that to figure out what's the probability that at least one of these H1 through HKs is consistent with C on m examples? We have to knock them all out, right? That's really what the goal is, to knock out all the ones that have high true error. So we failed at that if one of them still slips through, one of them still looks consistent and remains in the version space. So what's the probability that at least one of these remains consistent, that this still has happened?
Okay, I think I know that. So just like you did and before and did multiplication, another way of writing at least one of is to say or. So H1 or H2 or H3 or H4 dot, 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 or HK is consistent. And just like and is multiplication, or is addition.
That's true.
And there are K different ones of these. So I have to say this 1 minus epsilon to the M plus 1 minus epsilon to the M plus 1 minus epsilon to the M K times. So that would be 1 minus epsilon to the M times K.
Great. So that is a bound on the probability that at least one of these bad hypotheses is going to remain in the version space even after m examples. But how many bad examples, how many bad hypotheses are there? What's an upper bound on that?
Well, there might be one or there might be two. There's actually k of them, but we know that k itself is bound by the total number of hypotheses.
Yeah, that's right. So it has to be, you know, the number of bad hypotheses. We assumed if c is equal to h anyway, that there's at least one that is not bad. but you know, almost H of them can be bad. So that should give us a bound. Mm-hmm. All right. So now we're going to work on this expression a little bit more to put it in a more convenient form.
Okay.